Good morning.
Good morning.
How we doing? Oh, you bring some grits to everybody? My belly hungry now. I ain't had no dinner. No, you get to eat. I'm just kidding with you. How's everybody? Sorry I didn't get you the stuff, but I finished it, so you'll have it. This is all from last week, right?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions from last week?
Pretty straightforward?
Mm-hmm. That means it's too easy?
No.
I should make it a little bit more?
No.
No?
Mm-mm.
Now, you've taken the class before, right? Okay, so you gotta tell me if I'm not getting detailed enough for you.
This wasn't taught, so.
What do you mean this wasn't taught? Tia's FATCA and automatic exchange wasn't taught? No? But you all had questions on FATCA, right?
Yeah,
I mean, this
modules
is,
were still included.
This is the syllabus that was given to
it
me.
It was included, but.
But it wasn't taught. Okay, well, at least I'll improve, I guess. From now, this is a lot of information here. Now, what I tried to do is not get too deep into the weeds, especially when it comes to like FATCA and CRS, into like the real technical stuff, but I do touch on it. Where do you work again?
Atlantis.
Huh?
Atlantis.
So this is the transparency class, right? Everything about transparency of tax information. And and so the syllabus, as we know, includes tax information exchanges, exchange agreements, what we call TIAs, the Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, better known as FATCA, and the Global Standard for Automatic Exchange, better known as the Common Reporting Standard, or CRS. And then I add a little bit onto this about where the US sits with respect to all of this as well, because that's always a question. And in fact, the reason why this is late getting to you, I had to go to Colombia this week to go try to meet with some potential clients who, because of the US's position that we'll talk about, is preferring to go to the US than to a financial center like the Bahamas. And so I thought it relevant that we touch on some of those aspects. EFG, right?
No,
PTC. PTC. These are Bruno's girls.
Same one.
Well, you got what, like 4 or 5 that work in there? I didn't mean it like that. I meant that's where you work.
Good morning.
Morning, how are you?
I'm good, how you doing?
Right here, trying to make it.
Right?
So we'll start on TIAs, right? And what is a tax information exchange agreement? Now, the differentiating point, and you'll see this, that we always have to remember, TIAs came first, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so we talked about the timeline last week, right? Where we started with know your customer, getting rid of bearer shares, AML, and then started going into tax matters from AML. And the first launch into those was tax information exchange agreements. And tax information exchange agreements, you don't have this in your book.
Yeah.
You don't have this in your book because I only sent it to him this morning.
Okay.
But you will have it. There's a lot of information in these. I think we have 30, almost 40 slides in this set, in this class. You all need note paper? I could get Miguel to say he's sitting out this class too. I told him he better not ask for a refund. Tax information exchange agreements is the exchange of tax information on request. So unlike FATCA and CRS, a country has to make a request to get that information. And it's largely driven, like everything, by the OECD. Starts with the United States, and then the OECD follows suit. So the purpose of a TIA is to promote international cooperation on tax matters through the exchange of information. These things started out early. The first one that we signed, we'll see, was in 01 or 02. And what happened was the OECD had this harmful tax practices agenda, right? Initiative that they were told to deal with. And that dealt with a lot of things. And what came out of that are these tax information exchange agreements between countries. And the tax information exchange agreement is an agreement between two countries for the exchange of tax information on request. So when one country requests it of the other country. And grew out of the OECD initiative. They said the lack of effective exchange of information was a key criteria to harmful tax practices. And so the OECD would, you'll see me reference a few documents in this, and you'll get all those documents digitally. One of them is a model TIA, so you can see what a TIA looks like, and you can see what's in it. And so the OECD has a model template tax information exchange agreement for countries to consider when entering into these agreements. And it's all laid out in standard format to support their initiative. Now, what is a TIA? Again, a TIA is a bilateral agreement, so it's agreement country to country, right? That's negotiated and signed to establish the official system of which exchange of information is done through. You're late. Oh no.
That I had to change.
That you had to change.
Yeah.
What are you resourceful now?
Morning.
No. I was off island this week, so I apologize for not getting it to you in a timely fashion. But again, for those who come in, we're talking about transparency today. And the first element of transparency is the TIAs. And we're just going through what is a TIA. And so it's a bilateral agreement between two countries to exchange information on taxes. It's of note, information will only be provided if there is a proper request. So that request has to abide by the terms of that TIA. Otherwise, a country can deny that request. And the country has to make what we call a prima facie case for the provision of that information. So when you look at the model TIA that you'll get, you'll see that you have to have specific information: name of taxpayer, where it is, what if they broke the law, all of these things that are criteria for asking for a request. Now, this is what has frustrated a lot of countries, that they have to abide by the rules. We know in these types of matters, people don't like to abide by the rules. You got the ICIJ, TIF and information. We got all this stuff that people don't want to abide by the rules. So this frustrates a lot of people because they have to abide by the rules. And like we said, it's not an automatic exchange agreement. So it's not automatic exchange of information. It's on request, and that request has to abide by certain criteria that countries strictly enforce. Generally, this is really any country, but the Bahamas can decline a request for tax information based upon these following reasons, right? And it's of note, the requesting party has not exhausted all avenues on its own to obtain the information. So this is what we call a fishing expedition, right? Have you guys heard of that term when talking about these TIAs? Fishing expedition. So, you always, you know, one thing when we were going through this initiative, we said there's two things we need in order to participate. We need a level playing field. So every country had to do the same thing, regardless of your big, small, developing, developed. Everybody had to do the same thing. And you can't allow for fishing expeditions. You can't say, okay, I want all of the information on all French citizens that you have at this bank. That's a fishing expedition, right? In other words, I have to say, I need bank statements on Ryan Pinder at this bank for this period of time because they broke this law, right? And so the requesting party has to have exhausted all other means to get the information. So they've had to have asked Ryan Pinder for it, right? They have had to go through any legal processes to get that information from me in their home country before putting a request in. Now, this one's a very hard one to deny a request on, right? against the public interest of the Bahamas. Well, you know, it all against the public interest of the Bahamas, right? And I don't know how many countries would be receptive to saying, we're not going to give you your request even though it abides by all the criteria, because it's against the public interest of the Bahamas. And that wouldn't fly. But it's in there, right? The request is general without specific detail. That's where we say, can't have all information on French citizens at this bank. It has to be very specific. And it was not made in conformity with the TIA, and very specifically in conformity with the TIA. Again, this is a strict interpretation request. And this, what did we say last week was the average, not length of time?
6 years.
6 years. 6 years to get information through a TIA process. Was general statute of limitations for tax crimes?
6 years.
And so, is the TIA effective? No, it really isn't. I tell them, sign all the TIAs you want, because we can't process them in time. Sure. We can't get it. We don't get them done in time. So what does it matter how many TIAs you have? Sign them all. Sign them all. Right? Now, what happens when a request is valid? Now, the Ministry of Finance is the competent authority for this purpose, for exchange of information in the Bahamas. So the exchange of TIA requests may come through diplomatic channels, through foreign affairs, but foreign affairs will give it to finance because finance is the competent authority to make these determinations. Right? And so should the Ministry of Finance determine that the request has met all the criteria in the TIA, so it's a valid request, there's no reason to deny it, you know, it may order all persons and all information to provide information. So has anybody seen a TIA request? In all of y'all's experience in this industry, you ain't never seen no TIA request? Oh my Joe. I've only seen two. Right? I think in 3 years we had like 7 or 8 as a jurisdiction. Right? We really didn't have too many. Right? But they say, okay, it's a good request. We're going to go ask the financial institution for the information. Now, that's how it goes. The Ministry of Finance writes the financial institution of which the request is being made for the information to go back to the Ministry of Finance.
Do they have, like, samples of these TIAs online?
I'm going to give you the model OECD TIA that will have... Effectively, that's the model that we use, right? And you know, we tweak it here and we tweak it there, but that's really the model used. So with this, yes, you'll get a model TIA to take a look at. And certainly, we have the confidentiality standard that all information must be held confidential that is provided to the Ministry of Finance. Well, that doesn't really help because they provide it to another country in any event. And we know other countries don't really keep information confidential. Right? So the Bahamas. Hello.
Hi, morning.
Good morning. Our first TIA was signed on January 25th, 2002 with the United States. Remember we spoke last week about the United States and how they bullied us into the first TIA? I don't think we signed another TIA until like 5 or 6 years later. Right? And it came into force in 2003. The United States really hasn't utilized the TIA. Right? Again, it takes too long. Right? There'll be a link in the page that you get where you can see all the TIAs that have been uploaded. I think BFSB has the most current site, current list. The one that we just did with, we approved it when I was in the cabinet with... one of them Russian countries, Georgia, I think. We just did one with Georgia, which brought, so you have 29 listed on the BFSB website, plus the one we just did. I don't think it's coming to force yet, and that's why it's not listed. But we've done one with Georgia. And so we have 30 TIAs. Now, you know, the Economist and all of them fellas, they don't think that's enough, right? But that's what we have. We have 30 TIAs. Now, there's from what I know, I might not be completely accurate here. There's one that has been requested of the Bahamas and under consideration right now. For all of you guys, you ain't heard it from me. It's from Italy. Italy has requested one. And we have requested one. We have requested one with where I just came from, flew in last night, Colombia. Anybody been to Colombia? Beautiful place. Bogota is a really nice city.
Scary.
Is it safe or not?
Yeah, man. Right now, I walk the streets. A beautiful city.
Well, yeah.
When did you go?
Maybe like 3 years ago.
3 years. When did you go?
Longer than that.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was out there looking for Pablo Escobar, but I couldn't find him.
So why would we be requesting information from Colombia?
That's a good question. So what countries have done, right? And you know this because you guys do a lot of business in certain countries that have requested them. Countries will say, if you don't have a TIA, you're considered a tax haven, and therefore we're going to withhold taxes on any structure done in that country. That's why we signed Argentina. That's why we signed Mexico, although Mexico just did an about-face and said, your TIA don't really matter no more. Right, so I told them we should withdraw it. If it don't matter, we should withdraw it. Right? We have been asked by Brazil, and we have said no. Why did we say no? Because they didn't lift these restrictions with a TIA. So what's the use of having a TIA? Doesn't serve me any purpose. But countries have been, we have requested with Colombia because there is legitimate planning to be done between Colombians and the Bahamas, and granted, it only works with, you know, it's only a consideration with tax compliant clients because they're not tax compliant. It doesn't really matter because they duck in the system anyway. Mm-hmm. But there's legitimate planning opportunities, tax planning opportunities for compliant Colombian citizens using structures in the Bahamas. And so if they say without a TIA, you're a tax haven, we have withholding on those proceeds and that income, then we need a TIA because you can't have withholding and then have legitimate structures. So that would be 30% is withheld and go to the government. Well, what's the use of using the Bahamas if you're going to lose 30% off the top? So that's why we would request a TIA. We requested Mexico. We requested Argentina for those purposes. Right? And so we've seen the use of TIAs or lack of TIAs as a retaliatory tool by certain countries. And so that's why we would go out and we would request a TIA. Right? So how does TIAs and the automatic exchange of information work? Right? So we said TIAs are information upon request, not automatic, right? And it is a bilateral agreement between two countries, right? We're going to go into some automatic exchange discussion and different things. But even in an automatic exchange criteria, you need agreement between two countries, right? And so in a lot of cases, you have a TIA in a place, right? We have a TIA with many European Union countries, for instance. And so in June 2015, the OECD, who is championing the automatic exchange of information worldwide, known as the CRS, Common Reporting Standard, said, okay, what's the easiest way to have countries come to an agreement? Should they have to negotiate a whole nother diplomatic agreement or not? So they issued this model protocol. And the model protocol can be used in cases where you want to extend the scope of a TIA to include automatic exchange of information. So I may have a TIA with France already, right? And I may say, okay, France, we're going to give you an automatic exchange agreement. Why? Because the EU is going to blacklist the Bahamas if we don't do it for EU countries. So we're going to do it for you, France. Instead of negotiating an entirely new agreement, this protocol lists clauses. And I'll give you a copy of this protocol as well. List clauses that you add to your TIA to turn it into an automatic exchange agreement rather than just an information on request agreement, right? And so you just amend your TIA. Add the protocol in, the Article 5A, I think it is, for automatic exchange, and boom, you have an automatic exchange agreement. All right? Doesn't get rid of the information on request element. Because what happens, this is what really is going to happen, right? And we'll talk about automatic exchange. But let's just assume that your financial information is automatically going from country A to country B, right? And so that is bank balances, account numbers, who owns it, who the beneficial owner is, who has control over it in the context of trust, who the trustee is, who the settlor is. You all did trust already, right? So you all know all these terms. Who the beneficiary is, all of this stuff, right? So all of that information goes from country A to B automatically, every year, boom. They get a big spreadsheet of all kinds of stuff, right? So country B says, okay, I see I have information on a Ryan Pinder, right? That's been provided to me. Doesn't match up with Ryan Pinder's tax returns. I have some questions about this. He ducking me and giving me all the information. So then they use the information on request element of the TIA to come back and request more information, right? So that's how it's going to work. So you're not getting rid of the TIA, and you're not getting rid of the information on request element, because that is still the tool for them to come back and ask for more information. If they have just enough information and have pursued it with you and still met all the requirements of the TIA on making a valid request, but now they have information to make the request on, they come back using the TIA. And so that is in actuality how it will work. TIAs and automatic exchange of information. And so that, imagine this scenario though, and we're getting a little ahead of ourselves, but you have countries, you have country A, let's call this country one, A, B, C, and D, right? That Ryan Pinder has some part of a structure, a bank account, or something in four different countries. That's normal, right? That's normal for our clients. They have money in different countries. They have structures in different countries. They may have a trust in the Bahamas that has an account in the United States, an account in Luxembourg, and an account in Mexico, right? Normal. So all of these countries automatically are providing the financial information that they have. They may not have the whole thing. They may have one bank account, right? This is where maybe the management of the assets is happening. This may be where the trust is, right? And this may be another bank account in the structure for a company under the trust, right? And they all have different pieces and all reporting back to country one on Ryan Pinder, right? And they're like, wait a minute, Ryan Pinder ain't telling me about all of this. And what's going on in country A? I don't understand how that works with country C, right? Especially if country one is France, who doesn't even know what trusts are, right? You can have the settlor in one country, the trustee in another country, the beneficiary in another country, the trust law in another country, right? And they're trying to figure all this out because they're getting peace here, peace here, peace here. And now you got all of these TIA requests coming back. Boy, it's bad to be Ryan Pinder that day, right? Now you've got four countries prying into your business, and you may be completely compliant. You may be completely compliant. Your structure may be in a way where you don't have to disclose what you have. Remember we said in Mexico, split trusts? Mm-hmm. Where the income side, you don't have to declare until you take money back. Same thing Brazil with funds. Remember we said that legitimate use of tax planning for the deferral of taxes to mitigate your tax avoidance? Well, you can be perfectly legal, and this is going to cause you an enormous headache. Anyway, that's where I see it going. That's my little policy discussion on this automatic exchange foolishness that they're making us do.
Does that cost the client, Eddie, or the clients who are countries who have to report?
That's why your lawyer's going to be busy.
So the client will pay for it.
Yeah, my client got to pay the lawyer. You better give me a retainer up front. You're making it very. That's why I tell clients, all those in banking would appreciate this. How we used to plan for clients. Used to have everything in A, B, C, D, E, F, G country, right? You have the client here, and you have structures all over the place. call it the spider web effect. So we used to advise clients, have a BVI company and have a St. Martin company, have this company, a Bahamas company, run it all around the world. Not today. Today I'm telling clients, only one country you should have everything in. And that's the Bahamas. To avoid this foolishness. Right? Because if there's one request, if there's a request, it's only coming once. Right? If there's a disclosure, it's only going once.
Does that work only if you have like a TIA with those other countries, or it doesn't?
Yeah, well, you would have to have an automatic exchange agreement. You'll see when we start talking about automatic exchange, which would come in the form of a TIA plus with those other countries, right?
Because I understand, like, even though you had A through D and you had one, he mightn't have a TIA with C.
Right.
So that wouldn't be possible.
But now they have a gap of information, right? Mm-hmm. They have a full gap because they're not getting information from a particular country. Mm-hmm. Right? And they may see in the financial statements money go into that country or something, but they don't have an information. So then they would really try to get more information, and they'd probably approach that country to get an automatic exchange agreement with them. Yeah. Right? On the diplomatic side. And so... And so TIAs are used as an instrument along with other agreements, and we have a competent authority agreement and other mechanical agreements to authorize the automatic exchange. Any questions on TIAs before we move on? TIAs are pretty straightforward, pretty.
Why did we opt to sign TIAs as opposed to TIAs?
Good question. So the question is, why do we do TIAs and not DTAs? What's a DTA? Double tax agreement. A DTA, remember we talked about, when we were talking about competitiveness, we talked about Barbados, right? And we said Barbados has an income tax, therefore they can have a double tax agreement with Canada. Right? We don't have an income tax. So what an income tax says, what a double tax agreement says, is that if you have operations in Barbados and I tax at 10%, then those operations are only taxed once at 10%, even though we may have a 35% corporate tax in Canada, right? And it creates, they use taxation as a competitive advantage, and because they have an income tax, they can have a DTA that gives this preference to these countries. We don't have an income tax, so we can't have a double tax agreement because no country is going to say, we're going to allow you to tax those companies in your country because we don't have a tax, right? And it's just a tax, you know, it's no benefit to them. And so that's why in a DTA, double tax agreement, generally there are transparency provisions in there where there's certain exchange of information and the like, right? Maybe not automatic, information exchange criteria. So we have TIAs. How long does it take for a country to get a TIA request generally? What's the statute of limitations? So U.S. says, well, wait a minute here. This ain't doing me no good. All these TIAs ain't doing me no good. It ain't only the Bahamas that just take a long time. Everybody's taking a long time, right? Well, because everybody hires lawyers, right?
Okay.
And so the information request comes in. You know how governments go. They sit on it for a little 6 months and they don't know what to do. And then they say, okay, let's ask another question back because we think this request needs a little bit more clarification. Well, they have government too. Ain't only the Bahamas government that's sitting on things. So that's 1 year. They answer the request, right? By the time they take a look at it, Ministry of Finance has another 6 months, right? Then they say, okay, this may fulfill the request. Let's go to the bank. The bank hires a good lawyer, Ryan Pinder, Graham Thompson, and says, man, fight this for me, right? So I turn around, I write the government back, says this isn't right because of X, Y, and Z. And they say, yo, you got a point, Ryan. Let me ask the government back again to clarify this point. By the time you finish with all of that, Six years gone. And the only person making any money off of this is
Ryan.
That's right. So U.S. said, wait a minute now, wait a minute. This ain't doing me no good. I still got a bunch of Americans out there with a bunch of money that they ain't paying taxes on. We put an automatic exchange of information in place where, you know what, you're obligated to give information. And if you don't do it, just like TIAs, we're going to give you a nice 30% withholding on everything that touches U.S. Well, U.S. dollars, U.S. securities, U.S. bonds, everything. U.S. correspondent banking, everything. So they have the power, right? U.S. got the power. And that's why they could do FACA. They got the power. And so the Internal Revenue Service describes FATCA, describes FATCA as an important development in the U.S. efforts to improve tax compliance involving financial assets and financial accounts offshore. It's a compliance function. I ain't no compliance function. And in all reality, it ain't a taxpayer function. Right? It's information to go after who? The institutions. Because who gets fined in the end?
Institutions.
Right? Would Credit Suisse just get fined? $2.8 billion? That's a third of our GDP. Right?
How long does it take you to pay those fines?
Depends on how good your lawyer is. Because a lot of them are settled, right? Mm-hmm. Not Credit Suisse. Credit Suisse went and they were found criminally compliant. I mean guilty, right? In the courts. And so they got to pay, boom, 1 year, then year. They took a hit that 1 year, boom. Yeah, you ain't see them close down, right?
No.
Yeah. Right? FATCA will require foreign financial institutions to report directly to the IRS, this is the default rule, information about financial accounts held by U.S. taxpayers or held by foreign entities in which U.S. taxpayers hold a substantial ownership interest. So it's about U.S. taxpayers, right? This is only a U.S. initiative. So how many of you guys do FATCA reviews in your business? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? And you're looking for U.S. people, right? And then you need to report that information, right? Just imagine what you're going to have to do for CRS. We only talk about, and we don't have many U.S. people. How many U.S. clients you guys got? Not many. You don't have to say a number. Compared to everywhere else? Very few. You guys may have some.
Zero.
You have zero U.S. people. So you file nil returns. EFG, right? Maybe. I know you got one RM that's the U.S. work. Right?
Yeah.
And so, I know plenty of things, you know. But when I was at Deltek, I was doing FATCA reporting, and we have some U.S. clients, but not, I think it was 10. We had 10 that we disclosed, right? And so that's the exercise. It's all about foreign financial institutions that have U.S. people and exchanging financial information automatically with the U.S., right? And so what happened? What was the timeline, right, with FATCA? The Hire Act was what had the FATCA provisions, right? And that was in 2010. Later in 2010, another notice that kind of gave guidance on to request comments in 2011, regulations released in 2012. Now between 2012 and 2015, when was our first FATCA report for tax year 2015, right? Delay, right? Because they couldn't get it together. And they still don't really have it together. Right? How many of you all have problems with the Bahamas Competent Authority? You be honest, I got them too. No, but that it's a hard process to put in place. Because everything is automated, right? I was the minister that put FATCA in place for the Bahamas. And we had to hire, it's public knowledge, we hired Ernst & Young to build an entire FATCA portal, right, for the government. Why could you, Bahamas government don't do nothing with automatic exchange of information. And then to go through that, and then you got to train the people, then you got to write, we don't even have guidelines, I almost said guidelines. No, we have guidance notes, we don't have regulations. But imagine that, you got law, guidance, and missed regulations. Still don't have regulations on FATCA, right? That's what happens when you leave the cabinet. Some things get left behind. But it's difficult, and it's difficult on the U.S. side to put in place, right? So, IGAs are intergovernmental agreements. And so we saw the default rule, we said, was requires foreign financial institutions to report directly to the IRS, right? We don't do that in the Bahamas, right? But that's the default rule. That's the default rule. Report directly to the IRS. Well, we don't do that. We don't do that because we have an intergovernmental agreement. And there's two IGAs. So the intergovernmental agreement is the agreement between the country and the United States that puts into effect and does all of the components of automatic exchange of information, right? And I'll give you guys all a copy of the Bahamas IGA, right? You're not going to be really tested on what's in it, but it's good for you to have for reference. So you can see all of the categories and how to characterize entities and everything with respect to FATCA. And so they're model IGAs, right? And we have a model 1 and a model 2, right? Two models. Model 1 has two different models, a model 1A and model 1B. Do we know the difference between these? So a model 1 IGA, right? Model 1, the financial institutions report through a competent authority, and that competent authority reports to the competent authority of the country, circumventing the default rule. Remember, the default rule was to the financial institutions report directly. Mm-hmm. But any problems with that? We have problems with that, right? Why? We don't want our financial institutions talking directly to the IRS. Why? Because that means the IRS talks directly to our financial institutions. Right? We don't want the IRS governing how and compliance with FATCA. We want our own regulators doing that. We're a sovereign country. And we have an industry that we need to try to make sure is properly regulated, because that ultimately falls on the country. Mm-hmm. And there's no reason to have a foreign enforcement agency having direct access on your soil. That's why you have regulators. So model one, you report to the tax authority, which is who's our competent authority? The Ministry of Finance, right? About that. So model one comes in two forms, like I said, a 1A and a 1B. The only difference is reciprocity, right? Meaning, a 1A goes both ways, country 1 and U.S. Now people have a joke about this because they really don't do that, right? That's why you got everybody running to the U.S. now. But anyway, in theory, your 1A agreement has country 1 reporting U.S. on U.S. clients to U.S. and U.S. reporting on country 1 citizens and taxpayers to country 1. Reciprocal. Now, somebody like the Bahamas, when I went up there, I was negotiating this. They asked me if I wanted a 1A or a 1B or a 2. Let's talk about what a 2 is. I said, well, I want a model 1. I don't want you all in my country doing a bunch of foolishness. Right? I said, okay. Do you want a 1A or 1B? I said, well, I'll do a 1A. If you give me customs information, right? Because how do I collect my taxes?
Yeah.
At the border. Remember we talked about tax policy in the beginning?
Mm-hmm.
I collected at the border. So income information, financial account, and bank information doesn't help me. I mean, it helps me if I want to enforce exchange control. But that don't make me no money. I want customs information. I want declarations on the U.S. side. I want to be able to get invoices. That's what I want. And if you give me that, I'm happy to do a reciprocal agreement. They said, U.S., oh, that's Department of Customs. That ain't my Treasury Department, and we don't know. Otherwise, they said, Ryan, you talking fool. Right? So I said, okay, I'll do a 1B then. Because one, what are you going to do with the information? Are you just going to create another government bureaucracy for a bunch of stuff that's not even ever used for anything? I could only use it for tax information. I can't use it for other stuff. Right? So it don't make no sense. All it's going to cause is me to have to buy bigger computers and hire more people and store all this stuff and create a headache. So I said, it don't make no sense. Maybe I should have done a 1A and created a department full of Elizabeth people. It would help me, right? But no, I chose a 1B, right?
You weren't thinking.
Boy, hey. Would have been easier that. So I chose a 1B, right? Non-reciprocal, meaning Bahamas doesn't collect any information on FACA, on any Bahamian citizens anywhere, right? Model 2, Switzerland's a Model 2 country, right? There's only two Model 2 countries, Switzerland and Japan, right? They are a little off. But Model 2 said, well, we don't want the government in this business. It's a private sector thing. We don't want to create a bureaucracy. We don't want to create a platform. We don't really care what you all do. So you report directly to the IRS instead of going through a competent authority like the Ministry of Finance.
Oh, so they take that default model?
Yeah.
They take
effectively the default rule.
Okay.
Right? And so the financial institutions in Model 2 countries report directly to the IRS. Switzerland and Japan, I think, really the only two Model 2 countries. And so that's the difference. So we're a 1B intergovernmental agreement. And the intergovernmental agreement is an agreement, how do we say tax codes go? Legislation is this long and the guidelines are like this long? Well, the intergovernmental agreement is very similar. The actual agreement is like maybe 12 pages, and then all of the annexes and everything else are much more. And the annexes are what tell you the due diligence procedures that you need to undertake, how to categorize entities, how to report, who you report on, right?
Why would Switzerland of all countries
still do that? Man, listen, they were getting battered left, right, and center, right? Because you had Wedgeland, you had UBS, and you had all of this stuff, and the DOJ investigations. And the government was like, man, this is y'all's problem, this ain't my problem. Just threw it on the banks. Now they want to change. They've been talking about changing to a Model 1, right? Because imagine the banks, every single financial institution, and I'll show you what financial institutions are. They're not just banks. Every single financial institution has to report, right? So even, I'll show you, even your client could be their own financial institution because of the rules. And now your client has to report as well. It's a mess. It's a mess. And so I think they're going to go Model 1. Right? And so we have U.S. persons, right? Who is a U.S. person? Who do you report on? How do you know what a U.S. person is? Some people are by default U.S. people, right? U.S. persons means U.S. taxpayer. That's how the U.S. calls U.S. persons. And so all of these people are U.S. taxpayers, right? By default, you can't do nothing about it. You are a U.S. person, they fall within FACA. A citizen of the U.S., right? Including, this is very important, and someone born in the U.S., but even if they live abroad, right? And has not renounced their citizenship, right? Now there's a whole procedure in that, right? I had a client who's their client, was born in the U.S., left at the age of 2 months, never did anything about their status, never lived in the United States, ever. Filed returns in the U.S. as a non-U.S. person. The passport showed he was born in the U.S. Now, what's the bank to do? What's the bank to do? Right? If the rules say you're born in the U.S.,
yes, I hear you, and I know of a similar situation to where this person was born in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
But he carries a Canadian passport.
Mm-hmm.
And it has come up recently because now we're asking him questions. Okay, we can see something we had must have said he was born in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I've never lived there.
Passport.
We have his Canadian. Oh, yes.
Yeah, says where you're born.
Right.
And you're born here, you're born there.
He said, my father left with my mother was Canadian.
Mm-hmm.
I've never taken advantage of it. And I think he has filed, I guess he's kind of like a sophisticated taxpayer where he does have
yep.
a different, and we're still going after him about this because he has not done this renunciation thing. He's like,
right. But there's a whole process in the regulations, a whole process of how you renounce. And you have to file this report, and you have to file that report, and you got to get this, and you got to get that.
Yeah. So it's complicated
right?
then.
Very complicated, right? And the regulations don't give you any leeway in a situation like that, where this guy maintains he ain't no U.S. person. Never was. I ain't no U.S. person. Never filed a U.S. tax return as a U.S. person.
Yes, because he pays his taxes.
Yeah. So what does the bank do? Sometimes they take the advice of the lawyers, and sometimes they don't. Yeah. But born there, you're born there. You are a citizen of the United States of America, whether you like it or not. Right? A lawful resident, meaning? How many of y'all got green cards? I close my eyes, put your hand up. Right? If you are a green card holder, you are a U.S. taxpayer, and thus a U.S. person, right? Whether or not it's still lawful for immigration purposes. Now, that's some foolishness, eh? That's why you better go to the embassy and give that thing up. I don't want this no more. Take it. Because not only are you now have to be reported automatically, you should have been paying taxes since you got that green card. Why? Because U.S. taxpayers are taxed on what? Worldwide income, wherever you is and whatever you is do. Right? So a U.S. green card holder is a lawful resident and therefore a taxpayer and U.S. person and reportable under FACA. A person residing in the U.S., and we have this one. I don't know if it's worth detailing. We do that in the next class with the source rules, I guess. Someone spending a significant amount of time in the U.S. Now, you know, our clients, they just count their days, right? Count their days. I can't be in the U.S. more than this amount of days, and I just mark it off on my calendar. Those are good clients. Bad clients are the ones that don't really check, right, and get caught. In the U.S., if you can be not a citizen, not a resident, and still be a U.S. taxpayer, and therefore a U.S. person, right? How? If you're there for 183 days in any single calendar year, you're a U.S. taxpayer. You're a U.S. taxpayer. You go visit the U.S. 4 days a week, 3 days a week. Or maybe a little bit more. Get you 183. Or, if you go to the U.S. multiple years, which we all do, right? It's a formula. It's year one plus one third of year 2 days plus 1/6 of year 3 days is equal to or greater than 183. Right? Complicated, right? You know what you tell your clients? Forget about that. Don't think. This means that you can be there 121 days a year. If you're there 122 days a year, if it's multiple years, you're a tax resident. So just tell your clients, be safe, 121 or less, right? 121 or less, which is like 3 days a week. Many clients can go 3 days a week and not be a tax resident. Anyway, spending a significant amount of time, you're a U.S. person, and the banks and financial institutions report you under FACA. Right?
Someone like a student. You're studying in the U.S.
Students are different.
Right, I was about to say they would be exempt.
Students are different because students have a specific exemption under the U.S. tax code that those days do not count in the formula because you're there as a student. Now, if you're there as a student and you're there for non-school reasons, those days count. Okay?
So every time you go through immigration and customs, they log in those days and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why they are.
Yeah. But I wish they drill down into every single person. Like, at this stage, like in mind, the person would have U.S. and this here. They do the self-certification and they say, well, I'm not a U.S. person. I'm a U.S. person, but I don't have to pay taxes. So we don't report those.
But I'm a U.S. Point, what, say that again?
Like, is a self-certification
form. Let me make sure you keep your job now.
They went abroad, had their child in U.S. and they have a U.S. passport. So once you come into the bank and you have a U.S. and DC or like that, you fill out a self-certification form. And on that form, you declare whether or not you're a U.S. person for tax purposes or not.
You're born there, you're born there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, at which point, this is what I'm asking in terms of, you know.
At which point do you report them?
Well, I think regularly when you're reporting right on persons who have income, I think of $50,000 or more.
Balance in the account.
But I'm just asking in terms of the U.S., will it get to the point where they're going to, $50,000, maybe we'll lower that. Those persons who now have...
You mean you playing games with the factor reporting?
No, just... It's such a headache.
And I represent your bank, too. Well, it sounds like you need to bring me in. No, they should be reporting, right? We'll deviate a little bit because this is an important question. We'll deviate a little bit from this, right? So you hear a bunch of stuff, right? And I'll tell you what the rules are, but you hear a bunch of stuff. I don't make no $85,000. I hear if you don't make $85,000, you don't have to file and nothing. Not true.
No.
Not true. Not true. So the U.S., this is USA Taxation 101, okay? U.S., what are you taxable on if you're a U.S. person?
Worldwide
income. Wherever, whenever, right? Okay. So, let's say I make $50,000, I'm just what you say, right? I'm dual citizen for whatever reason, but I'm Bahamian, I live in the Bahamas, I work in the Bahamas, this is my home, this is what I do, right?
And they recognize dual citizenship?
Yeah. I was a dual citizen, up until, right? I gave mine up. I make $50,000 a year, right? What's the default rule? Worldwide income, wherever, whenever, whatever. I have to file. Your filing threshold, and there's a schedule depending on how you file and who you are, if you're married or not married and this and that, generally accept it to be $10,000 of income a year. You're below that, you don't have to file. You're above that, you have to file. You have to file. When you file your 1040, that's your personal tax return, or 1040 NR, you're a non-resident, right? You file your tax. I made $50,000 a year in the Bahamas, right? You are allowed, and this is scalable for inflation. I think the number is like 87,500 now or something. Anyway, it's in this range, right? As a non-resident, you are allowed to make up to this amount of money, $87,500, $90,000, whatever, a year, tax excluded from taxes. But you still have to file. You have to file to get that exclusion. Right? Exclusion isn't automatically granted to you. You have to file in the U.S. to get it. So yes, the answer might be, I don't pay taxes in the U.S., but it's not because you don't have to file, all right? And you have to elect to take this. And if you never file and you're making $50,000 a year, you are in violation of the Internal Revenue Code. And there are penalties for non-filers. And so that's your 101 on who should file. So all them Bahamians has come in, they know they need a good tax lawyer. I know one. He works right down there. But Bahamians are funny people. I'll sit there for 2 hours, right? I tell them, this is what the law is, this is what your assets look like, what do you own, what do you own with your husband, all of this stuff, right? Okay, this is the exposure, this is how we fix it, and this and that. They walk out, push crack, gone! I don't hear from them ever again. Never, 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 never. So I stopped that foolishness. I say, you got to pay me before you even walk in the door. So I don't hear from them no more. They go and they say, okay, Ryan just scared me. I got to put my head under the ground like an ostrich, right? Head in the ground. And wait, because the U.S. ain't coming after people like me. I don't make no money, right? They can come after your institution if that's how you comply with your FATCA, right? But the reporting threshold is 50,000. And if they're born there, they're born there. You can't make a judgment whether they are paying taxes or not, or they should pay taxes or not. That's not your judgment call. They're born there, and they got more than $50,000 in your bank, they're reportable, period. And they got to pay the consequences. Right? That's the proper way to do it. But I know that ain't always the way that gets done. I know that. Right? And so, you also have what's called U.S. indicia, right? Well, this is clearly default, right? But you have U.S. indicia, which, yes?
I have a question.
Yeah.
You said they have to have more than 50,000 in their bank account, like maintaining that over a period of time?
If you go over at any one point in the calendar year, at any day, you are now a reportable person. And that's only for FATCA. There are other F-bars and other stuff that's reportable on foreign financial accounts. But for FATCA, if it's $50,000 and 1 cent on one day, it's a reportable account. For U.S. persons. Right? So we see who U.S. taxpayers are. But that's not... The bank has some due diligence requirements as well. Right? Beyond the default rules. Right? Because if I'm a dual citizen... Right? And in the Bahamas, I open in my bank account with my Bahamas passport. You know? No, no, he's Bahamian, man. What you talking about? Right? So there's indicia that the banks have to... What's your address? Miami-Dade County, Coral Gables. Do you have a current U.S. residence or mailing address? The bank has to ask more questions. Right? Get a self-certification. Ask more questions. You have a U.S. telephone number. Let me give you my cell number. 305, blah, 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 right? Standing instructions to pay into the United States. Every deposit in this account, I want you wired straight to my U.S. account. Right? It's U.S. indicia. The banks have to ask more questions. Right? In care of or hold mail address. Right? Get asked more questions. So the bank is not relieved of its duty just because it's one of the default rules aren't there. Right? And so you have to ask more questions. Do more work. Who's a compliance officer in here? Or overseas compliance? Busy, 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 man. When they can give you all a raise?
So if I'm a Bahamian or dual citizenship, U.S., Bahamas.
Yeah.
I walk into Scotiabank.
Yeah.
Get my Bahamian passport.
Yeah.
Prepaid cell phone number from BTC.
Yeah.
My mommy's address, all that stuff.
Yeah.
They would technically...
They have no indicia of you being in the U.S. and
right.
They fulfill their obligation.
But I have my U.S.
Or
passport.
If you go to Scotia, apparently you could say, I born there, but I don't have to pay taxes there.
No, you thought that. You put that on the stuff. Details, you know. We don't give tax advice, so that's on you. If you
I got a good lawyer that I could send you. I only
even
want
like persons who use online shipping and you're using those with the U.S. address, they have to fill out that form as well.
But they're not claiming that as their residence, so you'd
no,
be
right.
Fine. Yeah, if there is no indicia on your account opening documents, even though you got that U.S. passport right here because you're going to Miami, right when you leave the bank, right? But you don't show it to them, and everything else shows that you are otherwise Bahamian. The bank has fulfilled its obligations. You are still evading your taxes in the United States or your reporting requirements. But the bank has fulfilled its obligations and will not report your account, right? And so the great thing about FATCA and the great thing that we do are entity classifications, right? Who do you report on? Who reports? Who's the financial institution that does the reporting? So in FATCA you have, and we'll see this, and this is similar in CRS. So this entity classification, similar for both. You have FFIs, foreign financial institutions, right? Who are the reporting institutions, right? They're the ones that report. They report on their clients, and they report on themselves, right? They report on themselves. So if there's a financial institution who has a U.S. person who owns that financial institution also has to report on itself. Right. 10% threshold. 10% threshold.
That's a substantial ownership that you had mentioned previously.
Mm-hmm. It's 10%. Okay. Yeah. See, they tie it. Well, it's a little bit different. Now, this is where it gets a little bit different between FATCA and CRS. FATCA says 10%.
Okay.
Right? CRS, Common Reporting Standard, says look at your FATF, AML standards and crisscrosses to AML, right? Some countries, their AML is 25%. Switzerland, for instance. Their control and threshold is 25%. But the Bahamas, see, that's why these ICIJ and these fleet people, they talk a bunch of fool, right? Because we're 10%, right? We're harder and more stringent, and they will get more reporting out of the Bahamas than they will out of Switzerland and the United States. So yeah, 10%. So a financial institution is a custodial institution. That's somebody that holds securities and bonds and the like. A depository institution, somebody who holds cash. So now we covered the banks, right? Those two, you cover the banks. An investment entity, that's where all the questions come about. What's an investment entity? So when you're figuring out if you're an FFI, it's easy. You're a bank, you're definitely an investment entity. You're a certain type of insurance company, you're definitely an FFI. Right? So banks and insurance companies, absolutely all the time FFIs. This is where we run into problems. What's an investment entity? Right? What is an investment entity? And that is likely what's applicable for all your clients. Are you an investment entity or not? Right? Much of my FATCA work I do for the banks is classifications on investment entities. Right? For FATCA class, now that's only like August, September. 2 months, right? Right before the reporting cycle, they call me, Ryan, I ain't a bank. I need to come classify these 50 entities for me. Right? And that's what I do. I do it. I probably this year did it for 5 different banks. Classified their entities for them. Right? Pay up front. So these are FFIs. These report on their clients and themselves, right? So what's an investment entity? Investment entity is any entity that conducts as a business, right? Or, this is a big one, this is called a managed by test, managed by an entity that conducts as a business. So either you're doing it, or you're a company managed by somebody doing it. So they impute their status to you. Right? And that's where you get into issues with your clients, generally on the managed by test, right? One of the following activities, right? Trading in money market instruments, foreign exchange, currencies, and the like. Securities. Here you go. Individual and collective portfolio management. As we've plenty of people fall, if they're not trading, they're managing portfolios. Because they're not necessarily conducting as a business the trading, right? Your client who has an IBC. IBC has financial assets. Right? Your IBC is managed by the bank. And so the IBC, who is trading in financial assets or doing portfolio management, managing, you know, your client is now an investment entity. That IBC is now an investment entity. Not a NIFI, we'll talk about what a NIFI is, but an investment entity. And therefore, it's an FFI and has to self-report. Right? And remember, these classifications are very similar between FATCA and CRS. So whatever you're doing for FATCA on these classifications, you're going to have to do for CRS. Now, there's a little difference in the managed by test, and I'll point that out. But the entity classifications are all the same, right? Or otherwise investing, administering, or managing funds on behalf of other people. So discretionary investment manager, right? So either you are one of these or managed by one of these, right? So if I'm an asset manager, I'm an FFI. If I'm an asset manager managing a client's IBC and his assets, that IBC is an FFI. Because I'm an FFI and I'm managing that other entity. And they're an FFI, right? A key thing to look at, and you probably won't be tested on this, but it's relevant for your practices, right? An investment entity is what? An entity, right? So if I'm an individual asset manager, I don't impute my status to my client. Why? Because I'm not an entity. Right? So there's, I'll draw it for you, right? And this is important for you all that practice in the area. If I'm RP, right? And I have RP Limited, right? So I have two things. And I'm an asset manager. I manage clients' assets, right? On a discretionary basis. They say, Ryan, you manage my portfolio. Client here, right? Client IBC, right? Really only a holder of financial assets, that's all, right? Typical structure. If RP Limited is managing that client IBC, this IBC is now what? An FFI. Why? Because I am an investment entity. Why am I an investment entity? I'm an entity who is otherwise investing, administering, and managing funds on behalf of another. That's what I do. I'm an asset manager. I manage people's assets on behalf of them. If I am RP individual, right, not an FFI. This company isn't in the business, doesn't conduct as a business. It's a holding company of financial assets. Now, that's not a business, right? And it's not managed by another investment entity. And therefore, this isn't an FFI. And it all depends on me being an entity or an individual. Doesn't that make any sense? Making chicken out of chicken. Yeah. I told my pupil that last week. Figure something out with this, because I don't know what's going on. You go make chicken salad out of chicken shit, you know? She looked at me like... She must not cuss. She's working for the wrong person. So that's an investment entity. And you can see how it gets confusing on how you categorize your client accounts. Right? Because you have to categorize it for reporting purposes. Right? You get self-certification, but you know what? If you don't know this, how do you expect the client to know all of this? They don't. And you need to make sure, because if you're sponsoring, we'll talk about sponsoring, right? You need to be sure what you're doing, right? So managed by test. This is an important distinction. I hope I have it in the CRS slide so you can get tested on it, right? We were talking about managed by. It's really one of the most important elements of this in being able to categorize what you are. Either because you're discretionary investment management, right? That's what we talked about, Ryan Pinder or Ryan Pinder Limited, right? Or common thought is, and I endorse this thought, I've issued legal opinions on this thought, it's not completely clear, corporate director. Because a corporate director actually manages the entity, right? And there's no clarification in FATCA on managed by. And so my position is, and others, other practitioners, is that if a bank, for instance, is the corporate director of an IBC for its client, even if there's not a discretionary investment management mandate, even if what we call it execution accounts, right? Where the client makes its own decisions and the client executes its own trades, and therefore there's no investment management. You say, okay, I'm outside the scope of the managed by test. No, not in FATCA.
Oh, still considered an FBI.
Under FATCA, if you're a corporate director and you're an investment entity providing directorship services, that's still an FFI. Because it's being managed by that. Same thing with a trust.
Yeah, I was wondering about that.
Right? Same thing as a trust. Because a trustee, by definition, manages everything underneath it. Mm-hmm. And so FATCA... And I've issued opinions on this. I think this is the right interpretation. And there are many banks in the Bahamas following this interpretation. Right? Now, if they're wrong, they're all going to sue me. Right? But they ain't that big a deal. Because most of them ain't U.S. anything. They'll report them, right? But in any event, if you're a corporate director, I think you satisfy the managed test under FATCA. Different under CRS. Under the common reporting standard, you still have the managed by test, you still have the similar language and managed by to be an investment entity, all that's still the same, right? Because they take FATCA and they just transplant it into CRS and then add to it. But they have guidance that says you satisfy the managed by test if you have discretionary management over the assets, right? So they clarify it. They say, no, we only satisfy the managed by test if you could manage the assets. If you're a corporate director or anything else that you're effectively managing the company, no, you don't satisfy the managed by test. But in FATCA, it's broader. It's broader, right? And I think corporate directorship is enough. And so now most of your clients are FFIs, newer entities. They're mostly FFIs, right? In the traditional structure, they're mostly FFIs. So what do? Because you don't want all of your clients reporting to the IRS, getting a GIN number, and doing all of this stuff, right? I didn't put GIN number in here, but it's kind of important, I guess. Global International Identification Number. Is that right? Two I's, one N? Right? All financial institutions have to get a GIN number, right? This will actually be a good discussion. All financial institutions have to get a GIN number. And that's how they identify themselves with the U.S. Even if they don't have any reporting, they have to get a GIN number, right? And so you need to be in a position where your clients, one, don't necessarily have to get a GIN number and don't report on themselves, right? Especially if they have no U.S. interests. All they're doing is creating a public database of all these foreign companies and stuff. And so what they allow for is sponsoring. Right? You can sponsor your clients. And so there are three requirements for sponsoring. So what sponsoring means is if I'm LRP Trust, right? Trust and Bank. Right, I'm like PTC, right? And I say, okay, I got all these clients that I'm either trustee or director or something for where they satisfy the managed by test, right? But they don't have U.S. interests or anything, so I don't really need them interfacing with the IRS. I, as LRP Bank and Trust, can file and sponsor that entity that I've done all the due diligence. I've made the determination there's no U.S. interest, and therefore this entity doesn't have to report as an FFI. Even though they're an FFI, I take the liability on behalf of my client. I've done the review. I've done the due diligence. Right? And so that's what sponsoring is. And so there's a vehicle to relieve your clients from having to self-report on themselves to the IRS. A sponsoring entity must be authorized to act, right? The sponsoring entity must register with the IRS, right? And the sponsoring entity must undertake all the required compliance. Those are the rules to sponsor. You have to meet all those rules to be properly sponsored. Right? There's always a question. Banks always ask you this question. Am I authorized to act? I don't really want to send something else to my clients. You know, they get so mad at me when I send them stuff and always asking questions. And right? You want to minimize this kind of compliance burden on your clients. Because what's the easiest thing that moves? Capital. You piss your client off, they go on somewhere else very easy and overnight. So you're always guarded, right? Y'all are always guarded about what you ask your clients for. You don't want to overdo it. So the banks call me and they say, Ryan, look, I'm a director for this company, right? I never got a specific sponsorship authorization document from them. And I don't really want to send something else to my client. They're so mad at me now for all of this compliance stuff. Am I authorized to act? My opinion is, you're a director, you're authorized to act. Because you are governing that entity. You are making the decisions as a director. So I take the position, yeah, if you're a corporate director, if you're a trustee, or you're in foundation counsel, or you're in some governance position with this entity, you're authorized to act on behalf of that entity and authorized to designate yourself as a sponsor. No problem. No problem. I even go as far as you don't even need a corporate resolution. Just do it. Just do it, right? And the new W-8 Ben E, which is the self-certification, the one now is like that thick, right? But they made that one big, hey? Clarifies that position, that, you know, if you're a director or otherwise, you have the general inherent authority to act. And therefore, you satisfy on. Register with the IRS, right? I think I have a slide on this. No. Banks have asked me the question. Right? Ryan, well, maybe I do have a slide on this. Yeah, okay. So, register with the IRS. You register as a sponsoring entity and you register yourself as an FFI, right? Mm-hmm. So you really register twice and you have two gins. You have a sponsoring entity gin, mm-hmm. and you have an FFI gin because you're self-reporting, remember? All FFIs need a gin, all FFIs report on themselves, right? But they have two different registrations, so you get two gins. You get one that you use when you report on yourself, one that you use when you sponsor another entity. Trustee documented trust, right? This is another important area of FATCA for us to know. It's very similar to the sponsoring concept. I'm a trustee, I have a trust that I'm trustee of. By definition, that trust is an FFI if it has a corporate trustee. That's the default rule in FATCA. If you have a commercial trustee, the underlying trust is by default an FFI. Why? Because I'm managing it, and generally if I'm a corporate trustee, I'm in the business of managing assets, right? And so the default rule is if I'm a corporate trustee, I'm an FFI, I'm a trustee over a trust, I impute my status to that trust is an FFI. Default in the regulations, right? And so this is actually something I negotiated. This is found in every IGA, because intergovernmental agreements have what's called a most favored nations clause. If one country gets a preference, that's extended to everybody. This concept, and I know the trustees in the room use this concept, PTC, you use trustee documented trust all the time, right? Because you don't want your trust to be registered with the IRS, right? Remember, all FFIs need what? A gin. Gin lists are publicly available, right? So when the IRS came to the Bahamas, I don't know if you all remember the conferences we had, and we had the IRS come down and all of that and do all of this good stuff. We had the biggest conference, IRS in the room, I gone, right? So I, at the Hilton, over a glass of red wine with a napkin, I said, listen, I got a big problem. This is my problem. I have all these trusts in the Bahamas. Bahamas is a significant trust jurisdiction. You are requiring every single trust, whether they have a U.S. interest or not, to to register for a gin. Because you're saying they are FFIs by default. Right? And therefore, you're creating a trust registry through the back door. Right? That's what you're doing. And my clients from Mexico, Colombia, Brazil, right? Blood is on your hands, IRS. That's what I told them. I said, blood will be on your hands for creating a trust registry on my clients who have no connection to the U.S. but get kidnapped now because they have assets and somebody can see the trust, the gin public list. I said, this is far outside the scope of FATCA. It's not consistent with the intent. You're trying to get reports on U.S. people. And you're forcing a registration of trust that have no connection with the U.S. at all. So he said, look, let's fix this, okay? And so at the Hilton, over a glass of red wine on the back of a napkin, I drafted the trustee documented trust exclusion. They took it, sent it to Washington. The next day, the language was approved. And now it's in every IGA in the world, FATCA. Right? So let nobody tell you that a little country like the Bahamas can't do nothing. Right? You just got to be smarter than them. And so now we have a trustee documented trust, and which means that the trustee can undertake similar to sponsorship. The trustee undertakes all of the requirements to certify that that trust he's a trustee of has no U.S. interests, right? And so the question is, and this was on behalf of a client, right? And I got into a war of legal opinions. My legal opinion versus U.S. counsel's legal opinion on this, right? You know, these banks, they don't trust you completely, right? They say, I can hire Ryan, and I ain't gonna tell Ryan, but I can hire somebody else, see Ryan right, mm-hmm. Right? They do that, they slick. And in this situation, the opinions were different. Now, it's a technical issue, right? But you trustees, you could appreciate this. The question was, in the context of a trustee documented trust, which gin do I use? Do I use my gin as a trustee, or do I use my gin as a sponsoring entity? Because this is really a trustee documented trust, not a sponsoring situation, right? And therefore, which gin do I use, right? My position was, you should use the sponsoring gin, right? That was my position. You should use the sponsoring gin. Because your trustee gin is reporting on behalf of yourself as an FFI. And even though you don't have a trustee documented gin, you have a sponsoring gin. And therefore, whenever you're doing something on behalf of a client, you should undertake to use that gin, right? U.S. counsel said, man, Ryan don't know what he's talking about. Because you're a trustee. And therefore, your gin as a trustee is the gin you should use, right? I said, listen, people don't know what they're talking about, right? I don't know what they're talking about. They don't know what they're talking about. Well, you know what? IRS comes out with the frequently asked questions and says, Ryan's right, right? You know what she said? Man, that's not precedent. That's not law. That's just interpretation. I'm still right. Anyway, the bank took my advice. But these are the types of technicalities, especially you compliance officers. When you're reporting under FATCA, it gets very confusing, right? And things that really, when it comes down to the practice of FATCA, are the questions that get asked, right? These are the types of questions that get asked.
I'm shaking my head because I remember an opinion coming in from you.
Yeah, I wasn't going to say you were my client, but attorney-client privilege, you know? Yeah, but it wasn't your office that asked for the opinion.
There was somebody in there because they came up and I heard your name and I was like, what? Yeah. I mean, not in terms of why Ryan Pinder, but they were now pressuring me to get some information from a client. And I was like, they're like, you know, we need this by this deadline. And I was like, okay.
Yeah. 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 So we have FFIs. See, I don't like to call client names in here, but I know some of them in the room, right? So you're an FFI, right? And that's what you do. We went through FFI, how you become an FFI, investment entity, managed by test, all of this stuff. And when you're an FFI, you report on yourself. If you're a bank, a trust company, or an institutional FFI, you don't want your clients reporting on themselves, you can sponsor them. If you're a trustee, you're a trustee documented trust. If you're otherwise, you are a sponsoring entity. And that's what you do when you're an FFI. But what if you're not an FFI? What if you don't meet the investment entity test, right? What if you are being discretionary managed by Ryan Pinder, right? And you don't make the managed by test. You don't have any corporate directors that are FFIs. You're outside scope. What happens then, right? Because it can't be that easy, right? Ryan would structure you all the time. You're a non-financial entity. So if you're not a foreign financial institution, you're a non-financial entity. We call them NIFIs, right? You hear a bunch of tax lawyers running around saying "niffy, niffy, niffy," right? That's not something, you know. That's what we do, and we are infatuated by FATCA. So a NIFI is a foreign entity excluded from the definition of FFI. You don't meet the requirements of a financial institution. If you don't meet, if you're not a financial institution, you're a non-financial entity. Pretty logical, right? And now, if you're a NIFI, you're either active or you're passive, right? Everything in FATCA is two, and then one of them has two more. IGAs, and then you have two more. FFI or NIFI, if you're a NIFI, you're either passive or active, right? And pretty easy determination and definition until you get really intricate, right? But we don't have to drill down in a lot of that. You're an active NIFI. Everything's default. You're an active NIFI. If you're not an active NIFI, you're a passive NIFI. Why? Because you report on passive NIFI. So everything that's not within this box, you report on. U.S. is slick, right? Active NIFI. When less than 50% of your gross income is passive income, and when less than 50% of the assets held during that year produce or assets that produce or held for passive income, right? So you're active if less than 50% of your assets and income are passive. Flip it around, because generally this works for us, although the definitions are contrary. If you have over 50% of your assets or income is passive, then you're a passive NIFI, right? But the definition actually works in the reverse. They define active and everything else as passive. But for our purposes, for our clients, generally it's if 50% of your assets or income are over 50%, you're passive NIFI. Right? Most of our clients are passive NIFIs. Why? Because most of our clients have financial assets. And financial assets, by definition, produce passive income. Passive income, capital gains, dividends, interest, royalties, rents, right? Anything that doesn't require the active participation is passive income. So most of our clients, unless it's a trust that's holding a plane and a boat for asset protection purposes, right? That's different. But most of our clients have financial assets or passive income, or assets that produce passive income. And therefore, most of our clients are passive NIFIs, right? And passive NIFIs are reportable if you have a U.S. person in that entity. I guess I should put one more slide in here that I don't have in here on how do you who's reportable on a passive NIFI. And so maybe I'll add something here. It's really controlling persons that you're reportable on, right? So if your entity has a U.S. person who's a controlling interest, you report on the accounts of that entity. So if we have an entity, right, let's call it NIFI Limited, right, because we're not a financial institution, and you have a bunch of shareholders, A, B, C, D, E, right? E is a U.S. person, right? And you have financial assets, right? And E, let's say they all are equal, owns 20%. Right? You report this to the IRS because you have a U.S. person who has a controlling interest. And controlling interest is 10%. Right? If he held 9%, that would be different. You don't have a U.S. person with a controlling interest.
Okay.
All right?
I have a question before you go on. So if you have a controlling interest person, right, and he is over the 10% threshold.
And he's a U.S. person.
And he's a U.S. person, and he is only E. Do you report on every individual controlling asset, or you just report on the portion that only E holds?
You report on the financial account of this entity on E. So you don't report 20% of the assets. You report the account. Report the account. Right? Because it's E's responsibility to properly declare their interest. This is only a disclosure regime, not who owns taxes regime. Right? So E could be perfectly compliant. I file my foreign disclosures. I file my interest in a foreign company. I file my FBARs. I do all of what I'm supposed to do in the United States, right? I do everything. I pay my taxes when I should. You don't always have to in this situation, but when I'm supposed to, I pay them. And so when this gets reported, the IRS says, okay, we got this report on E. His tax return shows he's got a 20% interest in the same company that we're getting reported. Okay. All right? It's a disclosure regime. It's not an IO taxes regime. So very many, many times you would either be compliant or not have to pay the taxes but have already disclosed that to the IRS. All right? And so that's disclosure, not paying taxes. But yeah, you would disclose that information. So NIFIs, FFIs, FATCA, this kind of the scope of what, and this might be, you said that you weren't taught FATCA? No, but I mean, in the class, the other international tax class. You weren't taught FATCA? That's why I had to spend so much time in the review question.
The first class.
Yeah.
Taught. But yeah, a lot of problems with objector. So we were waiting on that. Then he signed up and he would teach from the handout. And he taught from our. The second class, there weren't enough students, so he said, this is not enough for me to hold a forum, I'm upset, da 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 da, y'all wasting my time, I'm gonna be left. Third class, he taught maybe like a little over an hour, and then everybody was saying, okay, because the students were coming and he was upset, and so everybody's like, okay, we're lost, we're confused. His handouts were thicker than this.
Yeah, his handouts were not anybody else's.
It was a lot. And so, of course, person in the class like, no, we need this.
Yeah, he ain't teaching it, is he?
And he's like, no, we always didn't have time. I'm not into this. And that, that, that. So that's how that class
is. So I'm done covering FATCA, right? Is this any better than the prior class?
Much better.
Okay. I didn't drill way down into some of the stuff, right? That's really technical. It's important that you have an overview and understand that really, FATCA reporting and ultimately CRS reporting comes down to entity classifications, right? You got to know if you have a reportable person, that was the U.S. person, the indicia, the citizenship, all that kind of stuff. But then the question is, what do you report and how do you report, right? Because effectively, this has to be a level of practicality in this class, I think. I mean, I could teach tax code and everything else, but I don't think it's relevant. Any questions on FATCA? Did I miss anything that you practitioners think I should cover?
I just had a general question about the exam. So the whatever we cover here, based on the slides themselves, kind of thing.
Well, I don't write the exam, right? My slides get sent to Scotland, and they formulate questions off of that, and any handouts and materials. So they'll get the TIA, right? They'll get some other stuff I have that we're going to go over. They'll get the Bahamas IH. Anything I put together as the materials packet, they get as well, right? But by the time this is done, I think this is 65 slides we're up to now from classes 1 and 2. We'll be close to 90 slides, maybe 100 slides in the international tax module. And if they can't get 11 questions from 100 slides, then, you know, I think they got some serious problems. So I told Miguel that they should get the questions out of the slides.
Okay.
Right? That's right. That's what
I.
They use they yeah they. That's why I don't generally give a lot of handouts, right? Because I don't want them fishing for a question that really wasn't something we covered, just because it was in a handout. I mean, that's not fair on you guys, right? That's not the intent of this class. I mean, I designed this class as the minister. And that's not the intent of this class. The intent of this class is to get a practical overview of taxation and how it's affecting business and what you do, and all of you are professionals, and that's the intent of the class. So I've asked Miguel, when they send these over, to tell them to pull the questions out of the slides, and I'll give you very limited handouts to just demonstrate what we're teaching, right?
I had asked his archer to do the same, because you know that John Dryer has more than 400 pages, and so
yes.
If they submit that, that's where they're going to pull the questions.
Question. Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is very organized.
Right, so she needs to pull out exactly, you know, what she covered and then give them to Miguel, because otherwise,
yeah.
I think that was part of our problem.
That's part of the issue.
So we pull it from anywhere.
Yeah. Okay, we are running on time, so let's get through this. This is a meaty class, right? A lot going on here. But I'm not going through entity classifications again, because effectively, the entity classifications for FATCA are adopted by CRS, right? But what I'm going to go through is what it is, really why we are doing it the way we do it with respect to compliance. And those types of policy issues related to CRS. So we know this is really the order, and there's three elements of CRS. This is really where people get a little mixed up. It's really, we agreed to the standard, right? And the standard for automatic exchange of financial account information tax matters. We said the new global standard is not information on request, TIAS. The new global standard is the automatic exchange of financial information. And that's the global standard, and we agree. That's what we did. So when we sent our letter in I think October of 2014, when I signed the letter and I sent it to the OECD, we were agreeing that this to adopt the standard, right? The standard was developed by the OECD in 2014, right? So it's really not that old. They've been moving real quickly to implementation, right? Not like FATCA that was delayed. Right? And the intent is to provide a framework for cooperation on an automatic exchange basis between tax authorities of multiple countries. So it's FATCA on steroids. Right? The rules that you comply with to meet the standard are what is the common reporting standard. So the CRS and the guidelines and the guidance and everything are the rules. Right? And I'm not going to give you the CRS, because the CRS is 60 pages and the guidelines are 300 and some pages, right? So you have almost 400, and that's without the frequently asked questions, that's without the implementation handbook. If you include all of that, we're up to close to 700 pages of materials that are now referred to as the Common Reporting Standard. So I'm happy to give it to you on the side, but I'm not going to give it to you as a class because I don't want it on the test. Okay? But I'm happy to provide the materials to you. And so the third element, so we have three elements, I said, right? The standard, we adopt the standard as the global standard. The standard is implemented according to the rules of the CRS, right? And then a country has to choose how it implements all of that. That's the third element. You hear a lot of discussion about this, right? Bilateral, multilateral, the convention, and all this stuff, right? And everybody mad at the Bahamas because we took one approach and people was too dumb, couldn't figure it out, and now we were smarter than them again. Then we were smarter than the IRS, right? And we were smarter than them again, and they vex, right? So a country can choose its legal basis for the implementation of the standard. It's very clear in the Common Reporting Standard, very clear. You can choose the legal basis in which you want to do it. Meaning, you can choose by bilateral agreements, similar to FATCA IGAs, country to country, I'm going to exchange with you. Or you can choose by multilateral agreement, multi-country, by signing what's called the Convention on Mutual Administration Assistance in Tax Matters. We call it just the convention, right? The multilateral convention. So you can choose as a country how you implement the standard according to the rules of the CRS. Right? So it's kind of a tri-pronged thing. We clearly chose the bilateral approach. Almost every other country said they're going to sign the convention. Right? Everybody always asks me, man, say, Ryan, you being biggity, because I made this decision as the minister for the government and for the country. Right? I didn't do it arbitrarily. I had legal opinions and I did analyses and everything else. But I made the call. Well, I had cabinet make the call on my recommendation. Right? And they say, Ryan, you playing games. Why didn't you do the convention? All this headache would be finished. And we'd just be one of the group. Right? But we chose a bilateral approach. And it's important how a country chooses to implement this, right? It's very important. And we'll draw some distinctions here. The multilateral convention, right? It's broader than the common reporting standard. We only agreed to the exchange of information automatically. We didn't agree to a bunch of other stuff, right? That's what we agreed to, and that's why we chose the bilateral approach. The convention covers many more things. And here's some examples, and we'll talk about this, and you think if, as we go through this, this is something that you would want to do, right? Just in your practices. The convention covers a wide, not white, I'll fix that, range of taxes, including income, capital gains, net wealth, Social Security taxes, inheritance taxes, gift taxes, property taxes, and other taxes. Common reporting standard is the automatic exchange of financial information. Right? Remember, disclosure regimes, not a IO tax regime. Right? We agreed on a disclosure regime. Right? That's what the standard. Remember, we agreed to the standard. And the standard is the automatic exchange of financial information. That's what we agreed to. So we didn't agree to this. Spontaneous exchange of information. Remember our conversation last week. Tax evasion, tax avoidance. Remember that. Spontaneous exchange of information where a party to the convention becomes aware of information which would foreseeably foreseeably have tax implications for another party, including, what's this say? Savings of tax that may result from artificial transfers of property profits within groups. Tax avoidance is legal. Yeah. Right? That's what that's saying. They're trying to be wordy, but that's what that's saying. If you become aware of a structure that's intended for tax avoidance, you need to spontaneously give that information to the other country. Right? Okay. Remember last week we talked about, I'm a Brazilian. I have a fund. Right? Tax avoidance. Remember, this fund gives me deferral of income. Remember the deferral concept where we don't have to pay the tax, we reinvest it and it compounds up? And it gives me capital gains treatment when I redeem out of that fund, when I take my interest back. Right? Otherwise, in Brazil, there's no reporting, right? Remember we said this is similar on the split trust in Mexico on the income side. You don't have to report until you take the income out. Perfectly lawful. According to Brazilian law, according to Mexican law. It's a lawful tax avoidance structure. It is a structure that has savings of tax. So now, I'm the Bahamas, I signed the convention. I see this structure that is commonplace in the Bahamas. 60% of our new investment funds are this structure for Brazilian clients. Perfectly tax compliant. Now I say, oh, this looks like a tax savings initiative. And I got to spontaneously report this back into Brazil. even though the client has no obligation to do so. Now, what have I just done to my client? Killed him. No, you're right. I've just killed him. Potentially. But it's a real thing. So I said, no. And I told him, that don't work for me. It doesn't work. It's more than the standard. Right? Simultaneous tax examinations in other territories. Meaning, France's tax investigator is allowed to come to the Bahamas and do his own tax investigation on our soil. Why did we choose a Model 1 FATCA agreement?
To just do business in that country.
What was the policy reason why we did not do a Model 2 IGA?
Because you have the government coming
in.
This is an examination. This isn't even an enforcement proceeding. An examination. No. Right? No. Retroactivity. The convention is retroactive. Meaning, if your grandfather committed a tax crime, and you now hold the assets due to inheritance, they can come in and go after all the way down to the estate of the grandfather for this. Right? And the most that you can limit the retroactive effect of this is 3 years. So this is open-ended to when the crime took place, tax crime took place. But the most you can go is 3 years, or the least. Right? That's it. And so as a matter of policy, the Bahamas always, when we sign TIAs, how many of them are retroactive? No, we don't do retroactive application as a matter of policy. We don't do it. And so if we sign when we sign automatic exchange agreements, they're not going back 3, 4, and 5 years, right? So we don't, as a matter of policy, subscribe to retroactive application, okay? And so these are all part of the multilateral approach, right, that we had problems with. The bilateral approach is consistent with what we do with the U.S., IGAs, country to country, right? So we have a consistency of approach, right? It's based on the standard and the rules of the CRS, but only on the standard and rules of the CRS. Not everything else, not spontaneous exchange, not simultaneous tax investigations, not all of these other foolishness, right? And there's portions of the CRS that allow you to negotiate certain variances, and we will take advantage of that opportunity in a bilateral approach, right? Allows greater preservation of the national interest while still complying with international best practices and what is required of us. So that's why we took that approach on how we as a country implement the Common Reporting Standard, right? And so you have FATCA and you have the CRS. FATCA, like we said, is U.S. persons, right? Mm-hmm. CRS is global, right? Income of U.S. taxpayers, right? And exclusively bilateral, right? CRS, we're encouraged to be a multilateral approach. You said, we're smarter than you, I'm sorry. And they get vexed. That's okay. People get vexed. And really, it treats structures illogically. We'll touch on this, but the CRS is very confusing, especially when it deals with trusts. For all of you trustees who have started to look at the CRS and how you're going to apply going forward, and you look at trusts, whether it's an FFI or a passive NIFI, remember, we always come down to characterizations. Well, if it's a, you would think that whatever it is, the reporting's the same, right? No, it's different if you're an FFI or if you're a passive NIFI. And remember, you can be a passive NIFI 1 year and an FFI another year and a passive NIFI another year. And so you have different reporting going on under the CRS. And you talk about confusion. Imagine France, who don't even know what a trust is, getting different reports on the same trust, different years because of how it's categorized. Stupid. Completely stupid. So we say FATCA is the blue box. CRS is FATCA on steroids. It's bigger than FATCA. It absorbs FATCA, generally, but it has greater application. Right? I put that in twice. So who reports and who is reported? Very similar. You'll see this. Very, very similar to FATCA. Custodians. Depository institution. Investment entities. Specified insurance companies. Now there is an out here. Unless, and you can add things if they have a low risk of being used for evading taxes and are excluded from reporting. Right? Yeah, that's a little wishy-washy language. How are you gonna, what are you gonna do? I mean, come on. It's another thing is stupid, right? I find the CRS very stupid.
That might require more work because wouldn't that draw attention if you...
Right. And if the Bahamas says something, they ain't going to believe us anyway, right? So the financial information we reported, very similar again to FACA. Interest, dividends, account balance. I guess I should have this in the FACA slides. Sales proceeds, gains, the like, right? And everything is defined by what is a reportable account. So a reportable account is an account held by a reportable person. A reportable person is somebody who is a resident of a jurisdiction, which you have an agreement with, or is a controlling person of an entity, right? Remember the 10% threshold, right? If you're a passive NIFI. If you're an FFI, you're an equity interest holder. If you're an FFI, we correctly pointed out under FATCA that the threshold is what? 10% by statute, by agreement. Mm-hmm. Under CRS, if you're an FFI, equity, they define as an equity or debt interest, right? But you'll never find a definition of debt in the CRS, and you'll only find a definition of equity as it relates to trusts and foundations. There is no threshold of equity interest when you're talking about an FFI. All right? Another stupid thing, right? Because when you are a passive NIFI, right? The term is controlling interest, right? What is a controlling interest? So how do you report on something at 10% if you're a passive NIFI and have no definition of thresholds if you're an FFI? The end game is still to report on the owner. Because FFIs, remember, report on themselves. They report on counts and they report on themselves. So if you don't have the same threshold, now you got confusion again, right? Again, if I'm an FFI 1 year, I have no threshold. If now I'm a passive NIFI another year, I have a 10% threshold. I'm the receiving country, and I see 1 year you report on my resident, and the next year you don't report, and the next year you do report. Stupid, right? Now, I've been retained to draft the legislation, the regulations, and the guidance notes for CRS, right? First drafts are already done and into government. I eliminate this stupidity, right, in my law. I put a 10% threshold on equity interest. Listen, you need, we're still achieving the same goal.
Yeah.
We're not
yeah.
circumventing the goal
yeah.
of reporting, right? But you guys have to have some clarity when you do this, right? You have to have clarity. And so, again, that's some key differences, right? Your implementation, we're running out of time. We'll go through this real quickly because, well, this is pretty important. Your implementation of the CRS is important, right? Because the CRS defines pre-existing accounts and new accounts. And you have to know the difference, right? And you can have, so you have pre-existing and new, right? Pre-existing means accounts that existed before the implementation of CRS. You have entity accounts and individual accounts, right? For both of those. And your review on how you review accounts and clients before implementation, so we're talking pre-existing, has certain thresholds to help you along, right? And so, pre-existing due diligence review. So you've got to review all your clients for CRS. And you best do it all one time, right? So you know how to categorize everybody one time. And as agreements come into place, you have it all done. That's my recommendation, right? And you have different procedures if it's an entity count or individual count. Remember, we're talking pre-existing here, right? And then you have different procedures, whether it's low value or high value, right? So you have in your review as an institution, pre-existing accounts, entity, individual, high value, low value. So you have four determinations, right? As part of this review, this is one of the key points. On pre-existing accounts, you can utilize electronic database searches for indicia, right? Telephone numbers, addresses. And so you want to set up your databases electronically to conform to the indicia in the CRS, because you want to be able to do an electronic review and separate them into baskets electronically one time, boom. Otherwise, if you're unable to do that, you have to go to physical files, right? Which is a nightmare. So you want to be able to set up your client databases, this is for institutional implementation now, client databases that have proper criteria for the indicia, right? So you can do a electronic run and say, this is my Mexican group, this is my, you know, Colombian group, this is my French group, my Italian group, based upon an electronic review. Really helps you out a lot. Really, really, really helps you out a lot. Right? And so, for low-value accounts as an individual, right? Low-value accounts as an individual, still pre-existing. New accounts are easy. Self-certification, you're gone. None of this requires self-certification. That's why they split it, pre-existing and new. Low-value accounts, they apply a permanent residence test, right? For a high-value account, enhanced due diligence. So, you know, many of us don't have low-value accounts, unfortunately, because that's easy. Here's my permanent resident card. Here's my resident card. Boom, you're done. You're done for a low-value account. High-value account, you need enhanced due diligence. So you may have a lease. You may have a conveyance. You may have some other indicia of residence that you may have to document. Right? And I don't even have the value. It's 1 million. Oh, I have it on the previous slide?
There's a slide that shows it right
there. Threshold 1 million. Okay. So for individual accounts, it's a million. So for y'all that have accounts less than $1 million, that's good. But y'all are all big time institutions in here. I know all your clients have over $1 million, or most of them. Pre-existing entity accounts. This is a very convenient feature. Again, most of y'all don't have the, won't qualify, but it's useful in actually planning and structuring for your clients, right? So, pre-existing entity accounts, generally, your reporting thresholds, the controlling person, the equity interest of 10%, done on your AML reviews, right? So you have the AML reviews in your files already. You can rely on your AML reviews to determine on the threshold of ownership in order to be able to know. So you don't have to go back and do it. You can cross-reference your AML files on that, right? For pre-existing accounts, right? For high-value accounts, again, enhanced due diligence, right? Including a paper record search, actual knowledge test by the relationship manager. So you're saying, okay, we're allowed to do this electronic search, right? We're allowed to do this indicia, and I'm going to create some indicia and put it in my file. So this IBC that's owned by an Italian, you can make him Bahamian. You watch. Put in the annual residence card. I'm going to put in all this and all that, and all my electronic searches show him as Bahamian. But if my relationship manager knows that that's not the case, right? If your relationship manager, the knowledge of your relationship manager is imputed to the institution, right? So you can't play dumb. Just because you're a compliance officer, you can't play dumb. Actually, you're probably one of the smarter people in the bank, right? So when you know that your relationship manager flying to Lugano every time he wants to meet with the client, yet the client's showing as an annual resident of the Bahamas, you know that that's not right. And it's your obligation now to get enhanced documentary due diligence. And generally, requires a self-certification even on pre-existing accounts if you know that somebody's doing fool. Right? So, you go back to your executives and say, I can't classify this way because I know homeboy flying off to Lugano to meet with his Italian client. Another key feature, pre-existing entity accounts, if they're below $250,000, completely excluded from review. You don't even review it. So you have a threshold right there. It's an entity. Now you aggregate it so you can have 10 companies, right, in your institution. But you can aggregate cross-institution. How, if you have an entity account with 250 or 249, and you have the same BO with an entity account of 249 in your institution, you all don't know, so you can't cross-aggregate it, right? Easy, new accounts require self-certification. Boom, bam, bim, done. New individual accounts, right? New entity accounts, the same assessments for pre-existing accounts, however, it's easier to obtain self-certifications on new accounts. Generally, all new accounts are going to require self-certifications. Just like factoring and W-8s, that's a self-certification. You're going to require self-certification. So what's in it? Self-certifications are easy under CRS. They tell you what it must contain. Name, address, jurisdiction of residence for tax purposes, and tax identification number for each jurisdiction. Easy. Right? What's the jurisdiction, your residence for tax purposes? You got to rely on your client for that. If you have doubts, you have to go back and get more information to back up that self-certification, right? Right? He has reason to know the self-certification is incorrect. It is expected that in the course of the opening and procedures of the account, you would either obtain a valid self-certification or a reasonable explanation and documents supporting the reasonableness, right? So one thing that I would like the Bahamas to do, I've written I don't know how many policy papers to the government on this, I should have stayed in cabinet a little bit longer to make it happen, is we should have a tax certificate for the Bahamas, right? That says, if you live in the Bahamas, right? And we'll say for 90 days, or if you can demonstrate this is your domicile, closer connection, right, either through legal opinion or otherwise, and you pay a tax, whatever that might be, maybe it's a flat fee of 20,000, I don't know. UK non-dom, it's 90,000, and UK non-dom used to be 90 days, so I'm not doing anything the UK hasn't done. If you fulfill these requirements, I give you, as the government, a tax certificate. All right? You take that tax certificate and attach it to your self-certification. All right? You have done everything you need to do. Even if you have doubts on the legitimacy of his tax residence, you've done everything. Because you have gotten a reasonable explanation and documentation supporting that reasonableness. My closer domicile is the Bahamas. Here's a tax certificate issued from the government of the Bahamas that demonstrates such. Okay, boom, bam, bing. I fulfill my requirements as a financial institution. Right? Make things a lot easier in instances where we have a large expat population who are global citizens and traveling a lot. Right? And it raises revenue. Right? 20,000. Say we have 2,000 people that want to do that, right? Times 20,000. What is that? 40 million? Lord knows we could use that now, right? Self-certification forms, you have entity, individual, and controlling person forms, right? And note the controlling person forms for trusts. I'll attach the self-certifications for you. They're only really one page or two page long. But for trusts, protectors are controlling persons. Stupid, eh? Beneficiaries, and this is one of the distinctions. Let's see if I have... No. I can add a slide. Remember I told you the distinctions between passive NIFIs and FFIs? Right? Under one scenario, passive NIFI, only beneficiaries who receive a discretionary distribution are controlling persons and reportable. Under an FFI, all beneficiaries, whether they receive anything or not, are reportable. Right? Stupid! I fix that in my law. Right? You're only reportable as a beneficiary under Bahamian law to come if you receive a distribution. Period. End of story. And that's how it's going to be.
For the trust, for the state 6 day.
It says all beneficiaries. Or it's a protectors. I put that there to highlight protectors.
Okay. Because, I mean, I'm faced with Swiss institutions, and they want the owners of the trust to fill out these entities of certification.
Yeah.
And it's like,
move the trust to the Bahamas.
We're not
going to
get that.
Yeah. You should be able to do it as a trustee.
Right, but they
you
want
have the authority.
The owners of the trust company.
Yeah. The owners of the trust company?
I'm dealing with all the baby right now.
Oh, that's foolishness.
Well, exactly.
That's foolishness. So, last few slides. I'm sorry I took you a little over. Very meaty. But I think this is important for us because a lot of our clients are saying, well, I go to the U.S. because FATCA is different than CRS. Remember, FATCA is smaller. CRS is FATCA on steroids. In certain ways of structuring, I may not get reported under FATCA, but I may get reported under CRS. FATCA financial institutions don't have beneficial ownership information, believe it or not. Believe it or not. Whereas we know everyone here has to know the BO of the account. Right? And so under FATCA, really, there is no reciprocity. Remember I put it and I said not really reciprocity, but it is. Because they can't exchange BO information out of the U.S. because they don't collect it. So they only exchange entity level information. So it's not true reciprocity. And now you have reporting arbitrage. Right? Where under CRS, it's more reporting than under FATCA. And so people look at the U.S. now as the biggest tax haven with respect to reporting in the world. Right? And so the United States position is, I don't need CRS, I got FATCA. That's effectively what their position has been, right? And the OECD quotes it. They accept it. Again, stupid. Right? Clearly, I don't like the OECD and what they do, right? Right? But coming out of Panama Papers, right? U.S. said, oh, we can't be the next one. Imagine they teef our Delaware Papers, right? Imagine that. We're going to do something. Obama come out big and bold, right? These are my initiatives, Obama says. And so the U.S. is changing. So when you get calls from your clients about the U.S., know that the U.S. is changing. You now have a customer due diligence rule, right? You now have beneficial ownership legislation. We don't even have that, where it's filed somewhere. And then you have certain tax filings for single-member LLCs. We don't do a lot of single-member LLCs. An LLC is a type of entity in the U.S., limited liability company, that you can have a single owner, and for tax purposes, it's disregarded. It's as if it doesn't exist. So you can have a single-member LLC that is never registered with the IRS, but it's a legal entity in the U.S., right? And so a lot of people do that type of planning for foreign persons who don't want to have their information disclosed but want the protection of the U.S. And so
they're getting a lot of calls on
what? Single member LLCs? Yeah, well you could tell them that it ain't the same planning anymore. I'm going to tell you why. It's only a couple slides, so we'll be done in a minute. The customer due diligence rules adds a requirement on financial institutions, banks, broker dealers, mutual funds, futures merchants, right? Brokers of commodities, all financial institutions, that they have to collect and verify personal information. You're in the United States, funny, eh? Isn't this from the rule? I'll give you a copy of the rule. The real people. That's what they say. Know the real people. No, man, he's beneficial owners. Come on. Who control and profit from companies when these companies open accounts. So now, the U.S. financial, and this is a rule, so it doesn't have to go to Congress. This rule is actually in place now. Doesn't apply for a little bit time in the future, but this is in place. So financial institutions are going to be required to collect information on BO, which means what? Under FATCA now, they have the information to be able to report beneficial owners. So now it should be more reciprocal on information, right? And so you have to identify and verify the identification of the BO. You have to understand the nature of the customer relationship. I mean, this is stuff we do every day, right? You have to understand what the business is doing, right? You have to conduct ongoing risk monitoring and do suspicious transaction reports. They don't do that in the U.S. They don't know what a suspicious transaction is, right? Now they got to do that. Man, we should go there and teach them some things, right? But they have a 25% threshold. They take it right up to the max, right? Right up to the max. So controlling person issues, 25%, right? So you have five shareholders and you're below a controlling person, it's not reportable? That's silliness, man. And they get away with this foolishness, too, right? Beneficial ownership legislation. Now, you know, companies are generally controlled by states, state law. I have a Delaware company, I have a Florida company, I have a North Dakota company, right? And the only way to force those companies or the beneficial ownership reporting of when you form a company is to do federal legislation that trumps all of the states, right? And so there is proposed beneficial ownership legislation now in the United States, where the beneficial ownership is going to be reported to the Treasury Department, which is the department that exchanges information for FATCA, the Treasury Department. So when you form a company, assuming this legislation gets passed, you know, things go like molasses in Congress, when you form a company, your BO information is automatically now going to be reported to Treasury, who is a reporting entity for FATCA. So things are changing in the U.S. Right, things are changing slowly, but they're changing, right? And they make a statement: the misuse of companies to hide beneficial ownership is a significant weakness in the U.S. anti-money laundering, counter-finance of terrorism regime. Duh. Right? Imagine you were able to open a company here without knowing BO information. Yeah. Right? You can do it in the U.S. Do it online in the U.S. No BO information. Nobody knows. All you have is directors and officers' disclosure. Nobody knows. You don't have registered agents that have to have BO information like we do here. Right? Single member LLC regulations. Now, before, remember I said single member LLC is disregarded for U.S. tax purposes, therefore don't need a tax identification number or anything. You can go and form one online, use it to buy real estate, right? Use it to launder money, use it to do whatever you want, because you're not registered with the tax authorities and nobody knows the BO. Ha ha, sounds like bearer shares, doesn't it? Sounds like bearer shares. The proposed regulations now require these disregarded entities to have to get a tax number in the U.S. To get a tax number, you have to disclose effectively the controlling person behind the entity. So now they're requiring this with respect to single member LLCs, right? They're generally used to shield foreign, well, that's what they say. I mean, I use single member LLCs for all kinds of things, right? And some of it has nothing to do with the U.S. But anyway, they say they're used to shield non-U.S. persons, non-U.S. bank accounts, non-U.S. assets, right? And so they allow the IRS to determine whether there's a tax liability and to share information with tax authorities on single member LLCs. And so that's how the U.S. is changing, right? And that really concludes my transparency course. But these are the three areas when you talk about U.S. and transparency that we see a shift. The commissioner of the IRS has already testified in front of Congress that they should join the Common Reporting Standard. The multilateral convention we discussed is already being debated in the Finance Committee of Congress. And so things are changing. Now, the United States, things change slowly. Really slowly, but they're changing. Where am I going? And that concludes, I'm sorry it went long, it's kind of meaty, the transparency piece right here. Right. Next week we'll deal with these three issues. This really is another meaty area. Should really be broken down. These should have been broken down to three classes, really. But I know we don't want to do that.
I do have one quick question.
Yep.
Going back to the TIA, you know, I know you said it only has like 6 years. Can you resend it in or?
Yeah, I mean, there's no deadline on the TIA, right? Mm-hmm. But there's a statute of limitations for prosecution in the home countries.
Right.
So if you can't bring a case against somebody within that statute of limitations, then you can't bring the case. It's expired. We call it a tolling of the statute. So what happens is if it takes as long as it takes to bring a case as it does to get the information, then you effectively don't have a prosecution in your home country. So really the information is useless to you now.
Okay.
So there's no time period, right? Some get done in 2 years. Some get done, they're straightforward and less. But some get drawn out really long. And so countries see it as a useless exercise because that's been the track record. And they don't get the information in time to bring a valid prosecution against the client. Okay? Okay, any more questions? 25 minutes over, I'm sorry. I hope the transparency class was okay. And, that is really what the financial services practice is going to be all about, is transparency in these different regimes and really for you as professionals diving into these rules or hiring somebody to do it for you, because it's very complex and very, very, very confusing at times. You know, I sit in my office sometimes and second guess myself and I had to go back, and I mean, it's very, very confusing, very, very difficult. And so next class, we're going to deal with source rules, U.S. persons with foreign income, foreign persons with U.S. source rules, what are source rules, deferral. We'll talk about Apple. We'll talk about Templeton again and show how CFC rules and deferral and the like. And so that's important from understanding who pays tax to who and when in an international environment. Okay? Everybody have a good Halloween, trick or treat. I like plenty candy. I like the sours and the sweets. I think next class will be the last time that I teach until the review session. But I teach the review session as well. Okay? All right, everybody take care.